Schönen guten Morgen. Also vor so vielen Stühlen zu reden, bin ich im Grunde nicht gewohnt. Also jedenfalls die wenigen, die da sind, herzlich willkommen. Ich habe dann die Aufgabe bekommen, vor allem das, was bisher passiert ist, wie wir zu diesem Antrag an die Europäische Kommission mit einer Bürgerinitiative gestartet sind, wie es dazu gekommen ist. Ich will es relativ kurz machen, weil es mir wichtiger vorkommt, was der Inhalt dieser Initiative ist und vor allem, was zu tun ist, nachdem ja vor einer Woche ungefähr dieser Antrag von der Europäischen Kommission abgelehnt worden ist und unser weiteres Vorgehen besprochen werden soll. Ich bin der Überzeugung, dass die Europäische Union, wenn sie wirklich eine Union, eine politische Union sein soll und nicht nur eine Wirtschaftsgemeinschaft, dass sie im Bereich der Demokratie und im Bereich des Sozialen einfach mehr präsent sein muss. Und dass deshalb das Thema Grundeinkommen sehr wohl auf europäischer Ebene diskutiert und wie immer auch stufenweise in einigen Staaten, aber insgesamt das Fernziel muss meines Erachtens sein, dass in dieser politischen Union EU das bedingungslose Grundeinkommen zum Thema wird und eingeführt wird. Das war auch der Grund, das ist schon in den letzten Grundeinkommenskongressen diskutiert worden, 2005 in Wien, dann 2007 in Basel und ich war dabei auch 2008 in Berlin. Damals in Berlin war kurz vorher, hatten wir einen Durchbruch im Europäischen Parlament gegenüber Kommission und Rat errungen. Mir ist es gelungen, damals in einem Initiativbericht zur Armutsbekämpfung in Vorbereitung auf das Jahr der Armutsbekämpfung und gegen die soziale Ausgrenzung, was ja 2010 das Motto des Europajahres war. In Vorbereitung dazu ist in einem Initiativbericht geführt von Gabi Zimmer, habe ich einen Abänderungsantrag untergekriegt, wo die Machbarkeit des bedingungslosen Grundeinkommens zu prüfen sei. Also die Aufforderung an die Kommission, dieses Thema vor allem eingegrenzt als Instrument zur Bekämpfung der Armut und gegen die soziale Ausgrenzung das zu behandeln. Das ist auch von einer starken Mehrheit von 540 Abgeordneten, von damals bei der Abstimmung von 629 anwesenden Abgeordneten, also von 80-90% der Abgeordneten, die auch diesem Antrag zugestimmt haben. Allerdings passiert ist dann wenig. Wir haben in einem Workshop in Herzogenrath, ist in einem Symposium in Herzogenrath dann im Mai 2009 diese Idee weitergesponnen. Da war das eine ziemlich große Gruppe, da waren das insgesamt 7 EU-Länder dabei plus die Schweiz, die ebenso dieses Thema behandelt haben. Ich möchte aus dieser Resolution, die damals verabschiedet worden ist, einige Punkte vorlesen, weil die das Grundthema sind, warum wir uns in Europa mit Sozialpolitik, mit mehr Demokratie beschäftigen müssen. Damals haben wir so formuliert, wir stellen fest, dass aufgrund der ständig steigenden Produktivität immer weniger eine Lohnarbeit für alle gewährleistet werden kann, Entschuldigung, und dass gleichzeitig prekäre Arbeitsverhältnisse und Erwerbslosigkeit zunehmen. Wir haben festgestellt, dass der freie Markt und die Globalisierung der Wirtschaft nicht die vielversprochenen Vorteile für die Menschheit gebracht haben. Im Gegenteil, breite Bevölkerungsschichten verarmen, der Hunger in der Welt zunimmt und gleichzeitig einige wenige immer reicher werden. Dass die derzeitige Finanz- und Wirtschaftskrise einerseits und die Zerstörung der Umwelt durch die Verschleuderung von Ressourcen andererseits ein radikales Umdenken in allen Politikbereichen erfordern. dass es sehr unterschiedliche soziale Sicherungssysteme in der EU gibt, welche in den meisten Fällen sehr komplex und kompliziert sind, verbunden mit hohen Kosten für Verwaltung und Kontrollen. Dass die Kriterien für ein bedingungsloses Grundeinkommen, soziokulturelle Sicherheit, Rechtsanspruch, bedingungslos und individuell, gemeinschaftsstiftende und solidaritätsfördernde Elemente für ein gemeinsames Europa sein können und die Unionsbürgerschaft stärken würden. Und dann haben wir gefordert, dass das gerade im Hinblick auf dieses Europäische Jahr gegen Armut und Ausgrenzung zu behandeln sei. Daraus ableitend hat diese Gruppe von Herzogenrat, vor allem die Vertreter aus den deutschsprachigen Ländern, Deutschland, Österreich, die Schweiz war auch immer bei der Diskussion dabei, Luxemburg, wir aus Südtirol waren ebenso noch als südlichster deutscher Zipfel mit dabei, haben dann daran gearbeitet und sind dann zu dem gekommen, was Klaus Sambor vorstellen wird, zu dieser europäischen Bürgerinitiative, die wir glauben, dass die sinnvoll ist. Zunächst wird aber die europäische Bürgerinitiative als Instrument, Themen in Europa weiterzubringen, wird Gerald Häfner vortragen.
Ja, das hat irgendwie was Archaisches, wenn man sich hier erhebt. Aber eben nicht den Stühlen predigt, sondern den wenigen, die erfreulicherweise da sind. Guten Morgen. Ich will, bevor ich dann dezidiert über das Instrument ECI rede, in zwei Schritten sozusagen eine kurze Herleitung dorthin machen. Der Kongress insgesamt heißt ja Wege zum Grundeinkommen. Und das heißt, die Kernfrage ist eigentlich die Frage, wie kommen wir dahin? Oder anders gesagt, wie kommt das, was wir schon denken können, in die Welt? Wie wird das Realität? Und ich meine, dass es immer zunächst mal zwei Ebenen hat. Das eine ist eine Ebene, wo man das Neue überhaupt erst mal denken muss, eine Frage des Bewusstseins. Es ist übrigens auch in ganz hohem Maß eine Frage des Empfindens, des Gefühls. Und dann am Ende aber ist es eine Frage des Willens. Und dazu will ich ein paar Sachen noch kurz sagen. Wenn ich sage des Bewusstseins und des Gefühls, dann würde ich sagen, wir sind eigentlich längst vollständig in der Katastrophe drin, die mit unseren falschen Begriffen über das Verhältnis von Arbeit und Einkommen zusammenhängt oder wesentlich mit durch diese falschen Begriffe begründet ist. Und das führt in Europa dazu, dass die Einkommen immer weiter auseinanderklaffen in allen europäischen Ländern, die Reichen immer reicher werden, die Armen immer ärmer werden. Im Moment sind wir dabei, mit unglaublichen Summen aus Steuermitteln nicht die Menschen zu unterstützen, auch nicht sinnvolle soziale, demokratische, kulturelle und so weiter Tätigkeiten, nichts, was Werte schafft, sondern all dieses Geld wird den Banken zur Verfügung gestellt und die Banken reichen es weiter an Spekulanten. Das heißt, wir füttern diese Mega-Spekulationsmaschine und wir zerstören das gesellschaftliche, soziale Leben, den sozialen Zusammenhalt, mittelfristig und langfristig auch die Natur, unsere Umwelt, das Klima. Und das wird betrachtet, als sei es unabänderlich, wie wenn das nach Naturgesetzen so geschehe. Es folgt aber nicht Naturgesetzen, sondern es folgt von menschengemachten Gesetzen. Und diese von Menschen gemachten Gesetze, die muss man ändern. Die kann man auch ändern, weil Gesetze kommen von Menschen und können auch nur durch Menschen geändert werden, in einer Demokratie durch die Bürgerinnen und Bürger selbst. Und das ist der nächste und der entscheidende Punkt für uns. Wir müssen dahin kommen, dass die Menschen diese Zusammenhänge begreifen. Das heißt, aus der Wut, aus dem gefühlten Unrecht folgt noch nicht die notwendige Veränderung, sondern man muss begreifen, wo die Ursachen liegen. Und man muss an die Wurzel gehen dieser Ursachen und nicht irgendwelche Systemkosmetik betreiben. Und ein Punkt, der so eine Wurzel betrifft, ist nicht die einzige Wurzel. Ich sehe drei zentrale Wurzeln, aber eine davon und eine der wichtigsten ist die, die ich vorher angesprochen habe, unser falsches Denken über Arbeit und über Einkommen und die falschen Begriffe, die, wenn wir das nicht überdenken und korrigieren, immer tiefer in diese Katastrophe führen werden, in eine Welt, in der ich wirklich nicht mehr leben will, in der einige wenige in Saus und Braus, in großem Reichtum leben und der größte Teil der Menschen, dorthin wird die Entwicklung gehen, gewissermaßen zuschaut, ruhig gestellt wird und an der Armutsgrenze knappst. Wenn wir die Entwicklungen, die Einkommensentwicklung der letzten zwei Jahrzehnte extrapolieren und uns überlegen, was das in der Zukunft heißt, dann wird mir schwarz vor Augen. Und ich glaube, das muss man in Europa auch thematisieren. Übrigens auch in der Europäischen Kommission, im Europäischen Parlament. Denn es stehen ja alle diese wunderbaren Ziele in den Verträgen vom sozialen Zusammenhalt, von Würde des Menschen. Und dann wird aufgefächert, was das alles gerade in sozialer Hinsicht heißt. Nichts passiert. Aber es passiert eben auch deshalb nichts, weil die Dinge wie naturgesetzlich wahrgenommen und hingenommen werden und nicht über wirkliche Änderungen nachgedacht wird. Also der erste Job, den wir zu leisten haben, ist, diese Zusammenhänge deutlich zu machen und deutlich zu machen, dass der Schritt, jedem Menschen in der heutigen Zeit ein Grundeinkommen als Menschenrecht zuzugestehen, Ausdruck der Menschenwürde in einer modernen arbeitsteiligen Gesellschaft ist und notwendige Konsequenz dieser arbeitsteiligen Gesellschaft, weil Reichtümer, weil Mehrwert, weil das, was gesellschaftlich erzeugt wird, gemeinsam erzeugt wird. Und es ist überhaupt nicht möglich, individuell auszurechnen, was der Anteil des Einzelnen ist. Das ist alles rein fiktiv. Und insbesondere im Bereich der leistungslosen Einkommen, die ja heute immer mehr das Übergewicht gewinnen, also Einkommen aus Vermögen, aus Kapitalrendite und so weiter, ist es so, dass diejenigen, die dieses Einkommen beziehen, sich Reichtümer anmaßen, die andere erzeugen. Sie haben daran in der Regel keinerlei Anteil. Also das wollte ich kurz sagen, weil ich glaube, mit dem Thema, über das wir hier reden, an dem ich selbst seit über 30 Jahren arbeite, sind wir im Zentrum der heutigen Krise und nicht irgendwo daneben am Rande. Aber das müssen wir deutlich machen. Und das nächste ist dann die Frage, ja und wie kann sich die Sache dann ändern? Und da ist es in der Demokratie schlicht und einfach so, dass die einzige Chance, die wir haben, ist, auf eine Bewusstseinsänderung der Menschen zu setzen und dies mit den Menschen, das heißt mit den Bürgerinnen und Bürgern, durchzusetzen. Ich bin fest davon überzeugt, dass das die einzige Chance ist, weil diejenigen, die von den gegenwärtigen Verhältnissen profitieren, von sich aus eine solche Änderung nicht vornehmen werden. Und das können wir ja jetzt beobachten. All das, was politisch gegenwärtig getan wird, geht in eine völlig andere Richtung. Und das hat damit zu tun, dass die Politiker den Expertinnen und Experten aus der Banken- und Finanzbranche folgen und nicht dem, was die Bürgerinnen und Bürger verlangen. Aber die Bürgerinnen und Bürger müssen eben auch was Konkretes verlangen. Sie müssen zum Beispiel die Einführung eines garantierten Grundeinkommens für alle gleich als Menschenrecht, personenbezogen und so weiter fordern und nicht einfach nur, leiden und schweigen oder auf die Straße gehen und allgemeinen Unmut äußern. Was können wir in Europa tun, um zu einer solchen Entscheidung zu kommen, ein garantiertes Grundeinkommen einzuführen? Wir haben das Problem in Europa, dass bislang nicht die Bürgerinnen und Bürger selbst darüber entscheiden können, welche Rechtsordnungen in Europa gelten und dass auch das Europäische Parlament, dem der Sepp angehört hat, dem gegenwärtig ich angehöre, wo also immer wieder auch Menschen tätig sind, die mit aller Kraft versuchen, in diese Richtung etwas zu übernehmen, wo man deutlich sagen muss, dass das Europäische Parlament selbst auch seinerseits nicht, noch nicht die ausreichenden Kompetenzen hat, um das zu tun. Wir haben es, ich greife jetzt mal ein bisschen zurück, ich selbst bin neben meines Engagements für das Grundeinkommen seit ebenfalls etwa 30 Jahren engagiert für eine Weiterentwicklung unserer Demokratie, für mehr direkte Demokratie. Das hat damit zu tun, dass ich sehr früh bei meinen Anfängen politischer Arbeit gemerkt habe, es reicht eben nicht aus, zu protestieren, zu demonstrieren, zu appellieren und zu hoffen, dass diejenigen, die über die entsprechenden Macht- und Herrschaftsmittel verfügen, dann schon das Richtige entscheiden werden, sondern wir müssen die Demokratie selbst ändern. Und zwar so, dass die Bürgerinnen und Bürger nicht alle vier Jahre einfach nur oder alle fünf Jahre ihre Stimme abgeben, sondern dass die Bürgerinnen und Bürger selbst substanzielle, wichtige, einschneidende Entscheidungen treffen können. Sonst wird diese Welt nicht substanziell besser werden. Davon bin ich fest überzeugt. Dafür kämpfe ich seit 30 Jahren jetzt, zunächst in Deutschland, dann immer mehr habe ich mitgeholfen, dass überall in Europa solche Bewegungen entstehen. Gegenwärtig leite ich eine Initiative mit dem Namen Democracy International, die europaweit und international Initiativen zur Weiterentwicklung der Demokratie, Bürgerbeteiligung, direkte Demokratie auf den Weg bringt und fördert. Und im Europäischen Parlament kümmere ich mich ebenfalls insbesondere um diese Demokratiefragen. Übrigens nur in Klammern, am Dienstag nächster Woche wird zum ersten Mal im Europäischen Parlament eine ganztägige Anhörung zum Thema direkte Demokratie und kann direkte Demokratie eine Hilfe für Europa sein, stattfinden. Es ist ein ganz großer Erfolg, dass das zum ersten Mal im Parlament möglich wird. Aber wir haben dann, als in Europa zum ersten Mal begriffen wurde, dass die Staats- und Regierungschefs die inkompetentesten sind, wenn es darum geht, mehr Demokratie zu schaffen. Denn wenn jemand nicht an mehr Demokratie interessiert ist, sind es die Staats- und Regierungschefs, die gegenwärtig sozusagen alle Macht in Händen halten. Als das zum ersten Mal begriffen wurde und deswegen die Vertragsänderung von den Staats- und Regierungschefs abgekoppelt wurde und man einen Konvent geschaffen hat, um über einen neuen Vertrag nachzudenken, da haben wir uns sehr stark eingemischt und haben es geschafft, ein erstes kleines demokratisches Instrument da reinzubringen, im Gespräch mit all diesen Mitgliedern dieses Konvents. Das ist die Europäische Bürgerinitiative. Ich habe bewusst diesen Zusammenhang auch dargestellt, weil erstens mir wichtig ist, dass man weiß, solche Dinge fallen nicht vom Himmel, die sind von Menschen erdacht und entwickelt worden, da haben Menschen gekämpft und haben das durchgesetzt. Und zweitens, damit man auch sieht, dass in Europa dieser Konvent das erste Mal eine Situation war, wo ein bisschen die Fenster und Türen aufgingen und sich Menschen einmischen konnten. Was wir im Moment haben, ist der Rückfall, eine Regouvernementalisierung Europas. Die Staats- und Regierungschefs wollen alles wieder alleine bestimmen. Und was wir brauchen, dringend brauchen, in der heutigen Situation, ist ein neuer Konvent. Ein Konvent, der nachdenkt über die soziale, ökonomische, fiskale Situation in Europa, über das Demokratieproblem in Europa und der grundsätzlich Vorschläge macht, wie es weitergehen kann. Wenn wir das alles den Präsidenten, den Staats- und Regierungschefs überlassen, wird es nicht zu mehr, sondern es wird zu weniger Demokratie führen. Es wird nicht zu sozialeren, sondern es wird zu immer unsozialeren Verhältnissen führen. Also wir haben dieses Instrument entwickelt, die Europäische Bürgerinitiative. Wir wollten, dass die Europäische Bürgerinitiative am Ende auch zur Möglichkeit europäischer Bürgerentscheide, also Abstimmungen in Europa führt. Das hat man uns gestrichen. Was man übernommen hat, ist dieses erste Element der Initiative, das jetzt so aussieht, dass wenn 1 Million Bürger aus ganz Europa eine bestimmte Sache fordern, wobei es da noch zusätzliche Bedingungen gibt, sie müssen aus mindestens 7 Mitgliedsländern kommen und in diesen Mitgliedsländern einen bestimmten Anteil der Unterschriften gesammelt haben. Wenn das gelingt, dann muss die Kommission sich mit der Sache befassen. Die Kommission ist nicht gezwungen, dann einen Rechtsakt vorzuschlagen oder zu erlassen. Es ist nur eine Einladung an die Kommission, das zu tun. Es ist also ein schwaches Instrument. Ich hätte es sehr viel lieber stärker gehabt. Und trotzdem ist es das erste Instrument, mit dem Bürgerinnen und Bürger in Europa Sachen auf die Agenda setzen können und dafür sorgen können, dass es europaweit eine Diskussion gibt. Das ist meine Hauptempfehlung, das Instrument so zu verstehen und so zu nutzen. Also nicht im Kern vor allem drauf zu gucken, was macht jetzt die Kommission damit, sondern im Kern darauf zu gucken, wie können wir es nutzen, um in Europa ein Bewusstsein in dieser Frage zu erzeugen und Druck, Unterstützung von Menschen zu erzeugen, um dann dahin zu kommen, dass die Kommission und die europäischen Institutionen in dieser Richtung tätig werden. Ich will die ganzen Details der Bürgerinitiative jetzt hier nicht weiter ausführen. Das können Sie alles nachlesen, wenn es nicht sowieso bekannt ist. Ich fände ganz wichtig, dass wir jetzt, ich will nicht vorgreifen dem Klaus, deswegen halte ich zu dieser Frage den Mund, dass wir haben diese Bürgerinitiative auf den Weg gebracht, das wird Klaus darstellen. Wir sind aber auch in einer Situation, wo wir neu nachdenken müssen darüber, wie es weitergeht. Und dazu würde ich gern ein paar Vorschläge machen. Das mache ich aber nach Klaus Sambor, nicht vorher. Deswegen höre ich jetzt auf.
Ja, ich möchte also kurz darauf eingehen, auf diese Europäische Bürgerinitiative und den Rechtsrahmen, der also im EU-Vertrag gegeben ist, im Artikel 11, deswegen vorlesen, weil mir hier ein Satz besonders wichtig erscheint, nämlich den ich hier fett angezeichnet habe. Also Unionsbürgerinnen und Unionsbürger, deren Anzahl mindestens aus 1 Million betragen und bei denen es sich um Staatsangehörige einer erheblichen Anzahl von Mitgliedstaaten handeln muss, wir haben gerade gehört, in dem Fall momentan 7, können die Initiative ergreifen und die EU-Kommission auffordern, im Rahmen ihrer Befugnisse geeignete Vorschläge zu Themen zu unterbreiten, zu denen es nach Ansicht jener Bürgerinnen und Bürger eines Rechtsakts der Union bedarf, um die Verträge umzusetzen. Und hier ist mir wichtig, dass es die Ansicht der Bürgerinnen und Bürger ist, was wir von der EU-Kommission wollen. Nicht die Frage, was die EU-Kommission selber will. Und das sollte ja eigentlich in einer Bürgerinitiative im Vordergrund stehen. Nun, so einfach ist es dann leider nicht. Also wenn wir dann schauen, es gab dann einen Artikel 24 über die Vorschriften, die dazu geführt haben, dass dann am 1. April 2012 diese europäische Bürgerinitiative in Kraft getreten ist in Europa. Und ich will jetzt auch auf den einen Punkt eingehen, der eben in diesen Vorschriften für uns so eine Schwierigkeit darstellt, nämlich es gibt da bestimmte Kriterien, nach denen eine eingebrachte europäische Bürgerinitiative vom EU-Parlament behandelt wird. Und nur wenn diese Kriterien erfüllt sind, dann wird sie sozusagen angenommen. Und da ist eben der eine erste Punkt hier offenkundig außerhalb der Befugnisse der Kommission liegen. Ein Problem, das offenkundig ist immer so ein etwas willkürlich auslegbarer Punkt und das ergibt dann immer Schwierigkeiten. Wenn es diesen Punkt nicht gäbe, wäre es natürlich einfacher. Aber ich gehe jetzt konkret auf die Europäische Bürgerinitiative, die wir eingereicht haben, ein. Und die Bezeichnung ist bedingungsloses Grundeinkommen. Der Gegenstand ist Unterstützung für die Einführung eines allgemeinen, personenbezogenen, bedingungslosen Grundeinkommens in Existenz und teilhabesichernder Höhe in allen Mitgliedstaaten der Europäischen Union. Das ist sozusagen der Gegenstand. Und das Ziel, ich würde jetzt hier die Definition von allgemein, personenbezogen, bedingungslos und Existenz und teilhabesichern überspringen, weil ich annehme, dass das sowieso hier bekannt ist und gehe also sofort auf die Ziele über. Die Unterzeichnerinnen und Unterzeichner fordern die EU-Kommission auf, alle ihr zur Verfügung stehenden Mittel und Möglichkeiten auszuschöpfen, um die Einführung eines bedingungslosen Grundeinkommens aktiv voranzutreiben. Gemäß den EU-Zielen, soziale Diskriminierung zu bekämpfen, sowie soziale Gerechtigkeit und sozialen Schutz zu fördern und allen Menschen bedingungslos die materielle Existenz mit voller gesellschaftlicher Teilhabe zu bieten, bedarf es eines Rechtsakts der Europäischen Union. Nun, das sind die Ziele. Und ich möchte eigentlich jetzt nur noch ein kleines bisschen weitergehen und ein paar Bemerkungen in dem Anhang erwähnen, damit klar wird, von welcher Art des bedingungslosen Grundeinkommens wir sprechen, dass das noch klarer ausdrückt als diese 4 Kriterien selbst. Und da haben wir also in dem Anhang zunächst einmal beschrieben, was heißt eigentlich wir? Also die Personen,
we means who are the ones that file the application for the initiative? That's citizens from 14 member states, so more than just 7. 7 is the minimum requirement. So there are representatives from Belgium, Denmark, Germany, France, Great Britain, Italy, Ireland, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, Austria, Poland, Slovenia, Slovakia and Spain. So members, citizens of these member states are members of the committee. And of course, they represent their culture, language, social backgrounds, and religious beliefs. But they all share one opinion, namely, the unconditional basic income cannot replace the social welfare state. No, it makes the social welfare state be more emancipatory, not so much compensatory. compensatory. And then we discussed this in Vienna. Compensatory means is this basic guaranteed minimum income. So there is means testing, etc. The government checks who needs what, and then this is taken from the common goods. So emancipatory means something else. We believe in this context that the unconditional basic income is a human right. It's a basic claim people have. Everyone gets them from the cradle to the grave, unconditionally. Emancipatory unconditional basic income is described by the following criteria. There are now earning biographies, and then there are, of course, systems which have some deficits because they are conditional, there's means testing, etc. We came up with this initiative. It is based on the Charter of Fundamental Rights, for example, and based on the treaties on the European Union. We think that we definitely need this basic income and that it should be unconditional. So what else would I like to mention in the annex? Okay, we are saying that we are trying to reduce the social gap within society. There might not be no longer debates about abuse and or jealousy, and we do not need that much bureaucracy anymore. Furthermore, it should avoid stigmatism and discrimination, and therefore we can fight hidden poverty. Now, let me get to the last page of the annex. Here we say that unconditional basic income leads to social peace. It identifies the identification of citizens with the European Union and also secures political participation. It also promotes basic rights, namely, human dignity is not just a fundamental right as such. No, it's also the real basis of all fundamental rights. This can be found in Article 1 of the Charter on Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Now, the introduction of such a basic income falls within the competence of the member states of the European Union, and this is a bit problematic. There are different ways to finance unconditional basic income. This is why we decided to not include the question of financing into our initiative. All the ones who respect the basics of basic income, the basic rights, can participate. So there are different ways of financing, but we do not want to exclude anyone, because of course we need 1 million signatures, and we do not want to exclude anyone who's interested. This is what we had in mind when we said, okay, we are not going to include financing in the initiative. Yesterday we had a very interesting discussion. We talked about a minimum amount which the European Union shall establish. This minimum amount is then the basic income. This makes it easier for the member states to introduce financing within their states. This is what we also mentioned in the annex. Now the details. Of course, that takes quite a long time. Details always take a long time. Here you see the relevant provisions of the treaty. We believe that based on these provisions, we will be able to register the initiative and then have the Commission deal with it. It's the Treaty on the European Union, then Treaty on Functioning of the EU, and then the Charter of Fundamental Rights. There are a lot of articles involved, and I also state why we believe that this is the right way to come up with a social union. But I don't want to dwell on this for longer. Unfortunately, I have to tell you that on Monday, the European Commission rejected the citizens' initiative. unfortunately. Now we are going to discuss our presentations with you. I just wanted to show you one last thing. Tomorrow, the Citizens Initiative will meet. Many members of this initiative are here at the conference in Ottobrunn. This is why we will meet here. Second point on the agenda is a discussion and a decision on further actions. Of course, first of all, we need to consider the rejection of our initiative. We need to see why it was rejected. And then we said, okay, we will consider this rejection and we can proceed in four different steps. So first of all, we could redefine our request and then file it for a second time. We hope that this second application will not be rejected again. Point one, I am pretty sure that we will opt for this way. We just have to discuss how we are going to redefine our request. Then we could use the TFEU Article 263, because there it says if we are not happy with the rejection, we could file an application with the European Court of Justice. But this will take 2 years or longer, and the result is probably not very promising, and we cannot predict what the European Court of Justice will say. Now, point three, we will file an application with the Ombudsman of the European Commission. Maybe this body will help us, but this won't be that easy. And then, fourth point, we will be radical. We will ignore the decision of the European Commission and just proceed as much as possible in a similar way as planned. So we will come up and create a real European Citizens Initiative, because if we cannot enforce our current initiative, then it's unreal. So we create this real one, and maybe we can then also file a petition with the European Parliament. We don't have to talk to the European Commission then. Maybe this way we can get enough signatures from the population to make our idea progress. So we'll see how we will proceed. Then we will present our joint website. This website is ready. It's a website dealing with the European Citizens Initiative. And you can access this website from 21 countries and leave your signature there, and then, of course, we'll discuss Michelangelis. So this is our agenda for the 16th of September. First of all, we really need to discuss the initiative. How can we proceed now that it has been rejected? Can we maybe file a second initiative? But we'll discuss this all on the 16th of September. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all three of you for your introductions. Let me add one thing. Klaus Sambor has everything in writing on this European Citizens Initiative. It was published just a few days ago. This is was written by Klaus Sambor, and he published a contribution here and also what Gerhard presented, as well as the initiative with regard to basic income. So you can also buy the book downstairs if you like. Gerhard, why don't you begin briefly or less briefly? Why don't you tell us how you think we can deal with this whole European Citizens Initiative, and then we will have a possibility for questions and answers. What kind of specific proposals do you have? How can we work on this situation? Right. I can do so immediately, if you like, or we can take questions first, whatever. But if that's what you think is best, why don't we just say something to begin with? A problem I mentioned before was the fact that the European Citizens Initiative is the only instrument we have where citizens can really have a say. They can have something put on the agenda. It's their only possibility to really have a say, as I said, when it comes to European policy making. But this initiative is not something which will lead to binding decisions. It's something that can only be used to put something on the agenda. And secondly, the European Citizens Initiative has a number of problems attached to it. Of course, we should not get caught in these traps. In other words, we should not be caught in these traps, otherwise it will not be successful. So let me begin by saying one thing. I think that these traps are something which are so restricting that the whole instrument is not of much value. So I think that this instrument needs to be improved if we want it to have a good, useful future. This was clear from the very beginning. The most important traps are, unfortunately, something that were put in the convention. They were not. It was a question of more democracy and initiative and referendum institute and the ECI campaign that we initiated just to make this whole initiative known, and the wordings that were chosen. No, these were amended, and the most important amendment was the fact that it says for the implementation of the treaties. That was added. That means it is only proposals which will lead to the implementation to the present valid treaties. So the Citizens Initiative is based on the present legal situation. And the Commission then looks to see whether, as part of the valid treaties, do they have the authority to become active or not? And I must say one thing to Klaus. This applies, although it does say that we're talking about areas where the citizens are of the opinion that a rule is required. This is the way it always is in legal texts. So if you want to read these texts properly, you can't just quote part of a sentence and omit the rest. Both conditions have to be met. In other words, the citizens have to want this, but it also must mean that this would be admissible in the valid texts as they stand today. So the problem is that in all of these articles in the initiative, all the articles referred to in the initiative, well, how should I put it? There is a reference to social competence here, but it always says that this is not does not affect national responsibilities. In other words, that this would not be the reason for new European competence. This was something that was discussed in great detail. The member states reserve the right to be responsible for social policy. Nonetheless, there have been additional European responsibilities, but the social plan, for instance, but this is a subsidiary right. So in other words, this does not affect the basic responsibility of the national states. So the question here, will we be able to find something to open the door for us, some responsibility which clearly, unambiguously can be used by the Commission and must be used by the Commission? And I do think that this exists. I proposed that to you, and I have worked on this in detail because this is a problem which became very clear to me, and I wanted to make sure that we did not run into such a trap. So I want to pick up on this once again. Let me find the right piece of paper. so that I can quote from it. And this is Article 156. 153 says that this is what was referred to by us. It says that both 152 limits this considerably, where it says that the differences in national social systems have to be guaranteed by the EU and not called into question. But in Article 153, paragraph 4, it explicitly talks about the responsibilities of the member states to maintain their and define their principles of social systems, and this is not affected by the EU responsibility. So this is mentioned very explicitly. The only responsibility that we can refer to in Article 153, and this is what the initiative made reference to, and that is the question of social security. And this is one area where the national responsibility is guaranteed. So I believe that as a result, if you take the same text and take it to the Commission, then we'll get exactly the same answer. So this is something that we have to think about very carefully. I would delete this option because I don't think that we will be able to generate any added value. It will not lead to an outcry in Europe. This rejection has not led to an outcry yet, but I think that we have to see this in realistic terms. We have not managed yet to make this a real issue where in Europe, and I mean all of Europe, where the citizens look to see what's happening when it comes to this European Citizens Initiative. Not very many people are aware of it. We have to overcome a certain threshold so that the citizens are aware of this, and this is a threshold where it will become difficult for the Commission to reject it. So that's why my proposal is not to take these texts there again and to start an ECI where we can be quite sure that they will be rejected. There's a second reason for this. I have organized a number of campaigns, and some of them have been very successful, and many laws that are valid here in Germany are the result of such campaigns. In Bavaria, for instance, in the municipalities and the districts, you can decide directly on certain issues that citizens can decide directly. And since 1995, since this law was passed, in more than 2,000 cases, we have done this as due to a law which I was able to write with a few friends, and this was a 5-year campaign, so I know how to organize campaigns. But if we were to organize a campaign with a text and were to collect signatures, and we can be pretty sure that it will be rejected, then we're wasting or we'll be losing the trust that the citizens have in us. They're not familiar with the situation. They said, I signed it because I thought you would write it in such a way so that it would be successful. And if you come to them a third and fourth time, then they may not be willing to sign. So they will tell us, think about what you're doing beforehand. So all of the options which say we would approach them with a similar text, or we will word it in a different way, but we'll be trying the same thing once again. These should not be done. We have to see, can we do something? Can something be put into these texts which will make it impossible for the Commission to reject? So we need to put something new into it. I'm sure that most of the wordings can be left as they are. The wording is good, and I said that back then as well. So I think that one thing that will not work, and that is the last part of the sentence, this would be calling for a binding legal act. That's what the Commission will have to say. We cannot do that. So instead of that, what we can add here to it is to say, I think we should find a wording which would deal with Article 156. And Article 156 says that irrespective of the other provisions in the treaty, the Commission will promote achieving the goals of Article 151, and this will be cooperation between the member states and will facilitate the decisions of the way ahead. And this chapter, all of the areas that fall under this scope will be social policy, also with regard to employment, labor conditions, training, further education, social security. And then we have some others that are not relevant here, but this point, Social Security, I think this is something that we can pick up on, and the Commission has a weak responsibility here, but they do have a responsibility to organize or to call for cooperation between the member states. And let me read this out to you. The Commission will work closely with the member states to conduct studies and consultations with regard to questions, international questions, also by means of initiatives, which will be to develop guidelines and indicators to carry out the exchange of good methods, etc. So, in other words, what can you do with an EB, with an ECI? What can be done with this ECI is to call upon the Commission to conduct studies on how income has developed in the member states, and if you consider current developments and if you extrapolate them, what the situation will be in the future, and to determine what possibilities the Commission has when it comes to introducing a guaranteed basic income in Europe, what legal obstacles need to be overcome, and how this can be done financially, what models are present for this purpose, and you could take it one step further and call for guidelines on this. I think just calling upon the Commission to conduct a study throughout Europe for the introduction of such an instrument is something that will be studied in actual terms and in legal terms. This is a big step, and we have to explain to the people that the introduction of basic income is something which at the present time is not possible from a legal and binding point of view, but we have to make use of this instrument to finally get the discussion on the agenda and to make sure that this discussion, now that it has begun, should be continued. That is what's great about basic income. Most people try to avoid the discussion on this. You can say this in the German parliament, for example. Generally, what we can usually do in Bavaria is to say that we're not even going to bother to ignore it, but we're not ignoring it. That means that we know if we have this strategy, if we're going to discuss this, then we are promoting this whole idea. So the best thing would be don't touch it. We don't have this idea. But once the idea is being discussed, then it will gain support, and it will also be passed, I'm convinced. So that's why we have to find an approach to discuss this idea in broad terms in Europe. And irrespective of all of this, we still have the problem that the ECI is not sufficient yet. And that is why some of the proposals we heard from Klaus, one of them was we will call it the real ECI, and that will have the text that we would like to have had. And we know that this is not possible in legal terms, but we'll try it anyway. And I think that this will be so complicated for our citizens that that will not work. So I think we will have to explain it to the man on the street and say, I want to have a basic income, I want an ECI, but that's not possible for legal terms, so that's why we're calling it a real ECI, and the real ECI means this, that, and the other. I don't think that will work. So as far as the ECI, this is where we need to become active in order to promote the discussion on this. And at the same time, I would also like to talk about all of those who have accepted the fact that democracy needs to be improved. The ECI should be reworded, and this should have a new convention. That's what I wanted to say to conclude. We have reached a point in Europe where the treaties as they now stand are not sufficient for us to do what needs to be done, especially when we want to reinforce social cohesion in Europe. So we need to amend the treaties. And for everything that's being discussed now, for economic governance, etc. But I don't want the presidents of, or the chairman of the Commission or the Central Bank and the Eurogroup, they are working on a draft treaty to amend the text. This is coming from the very top. I don't want that to be the case. That is to be turned into a convention, and they plan to take it. It's supposed to take 2 days. It's going to be done on a weekend, and then they will have a, they will simply agree to a text that has already been written. This is not democratic. This is totalitarian. We have to have a grassroots approach, a democratic convention, to see what is necessary in Europe in order to avoid or exit this crisis, what is necessary in terms of fiscal policy, social policy, so that we can finally turn Europe into a democratic area and not just a situation where the citizens watch what's happening and the bankers decide what happens. We cannot put everything into the text altogether. I think that would be too much. Thank you very much.
Herzlichen Dank, Gerald.
Thank you very much, Gerald. I would like to open the discussion for questions. I would be happy to hear your contributions. How can we deal with this situation? One remark. You can also get translation of German contributions, of English contributions. You find the German translation on Channel 1 and the English one on Channel 2. So, there's a question from the floor. Yes, just wait for the microphone, no problem. I think that's easier and the only way, really, the interpreters can understand what is being said. Well, I will try to speak German. I'm originally Dutch, but I'll speak German. So, Mr. Häfer, do you have a written statement of what you just said? And do you have any suggestion or any proposal which would be supported by any politician in the EU Parliament? Anything that could change the situation? Do you have a plan for us? Second question. In July, I participated in Paris. I participated in the drafting process of the European Citizens Initiative. I don't know whether attorneys drafted part of this text or not, because we were all laymen in Paris. We just wanted to improve the wording of the text. So my question is, do you have any information on this? Do you know whether this was checked from a legal point of view beforehand? Now, third question. If we ignore the rejection and if we presented to the European Parliament, can we then get into contact with politicians? Politicians from the European Parliament, politicians that might support our ECI. Can we not ask them for advice? Maybe they can tell us what to do and how we can reach our goals. Now my last question, last remark. Philip von Paris responded to this rejection. He repeated his statement, his point of view, and that was that we shouldn't focus so much on the social aspects and the legal points of view. No, that we should focus on the financial issues. He explained this to us yesterday. And this brings me to a statement by Clinton. It's the economy, stupid. Maybe we should focus on that point. Because I hope we will be able to enforce the ECI. And then if we are able to do that, then the social aspects will be implemented anyway. What's your name? Adrian Planken from Utrecht. Thank you very much. So, we heard four questions. Klaus, Gerald, Sepp, would you like to reply to the gentleman's comments? Yes, Klaus, go ahead. You have the floor. Yes, concerning your first question, whether attorneys at law had a look at the text. Yes, of course. The problem just is that these attorneys had different opinions on what is possible and what is not. I asked an attorney at law from Austria to give us an evaluation. He said that the European Commission should accept it, the text that we presented. He was wrong. We have the statement on the rejection here, and it's really unbelievable what they are saying. It says here, the rejection, neither Article 2 nor Article 3 of the EU Treaty, and these articles deal with the human dignity, etc., nor the Charter of Fundamental Rights, which explicitly refers to human dignity. So here it says, neither these articles nor articles from the Charter of Fundamental Rights can offer a legal basis for your text. So we thought that if you take human dignity seriously, then the Charter of Fundamental Rights can serve as a basis, a legal basis, or can substantiate our ECI. But the European Commission says, no, we don't understand why. Now, of course, you can say it's because they are not competent. But we will also consider what Gerald Hefner said. We thought that our text is admissible, but we will reduce it and make it refer to these articles because we want to enforce it. We want to have it accepted. I don't think that the EU Commission actually is right. Nevertheless, if this is the only way we can get it approved, okay, then we will reduce it a bit. And it says that we do have a legal right, that we required a legal rights act. However, there are five different ones. There are the binding ones and non-binding ones. And we didn't mention the binding one. We just said that we want the Commission to do whatever is possible and within their means. If they can make a statement, fine, or give us a recommendation, fine, or maybe give us guiding directive for the member states. Why should this be impossible? We don't really understand. Now, we have to deal with reality. We need to see how we can change the wording so we get it approved. But we do really believe that they are wrong. They can derive it maybe from the legal context, okay, but we take Gerald Hefner's recommendation advice very seriously. Our point of view legally was approved by attorneys at law, but now we will obey what they say and we will go ahead and answer their requirements, fulfill their requirements. In the beginning, I had said that we didn't want to include the financial aspects because there we find various opinions in the different member states. And Philip van Parijs said it yesterday. We left it in as a comment. So if it's possible to coordinate financing between the EU and the national member states, of course, we are up for it. But first of all, we want to have it acknowledged. We want to introduce generally basic income based on the five criteria that we mentioned. Switzerland serves as an example for us. In April, Switzerland started the referendum, the preparations for a referendum on the introduction of basic income in Switzerland. Next year, they will have the referendum, and then they will decide yes or no. And they deleted the financial aspect, financing. They said, okay, we'll talk about financing in a second step. And this is what we propose in our case as well.
Let me try to answer that question. I was addressed directly on this point. Now, with Switzerland, I agree with Klaus Sambor here. I think it is right for Switzerland not to focus on the question of the funding, but the idea behind it is what they should focus on. I think that's the right way for us to go as well. It would be wrong for us to focus on funding. I could talk to you for 30 minutes on that, but I don't think I need to. We have to be very careful here. I don't know how to put it. I think that working together in a friendly manner, if you really want to achieve something, if you want to change something, then of course you have to say what you think, even to your friends, if they're wrong. And let me put it this way, just to say, based on what was just said as a proposal from yesterday, but amongst ourselves as well, I would like to contradict very clearly what Klaus has said, because it's not right. If you say it's been looked into legally, but in Vienna, I made a presentation on that point and said that these legal points do not suffice, because for everything that you have listed, if you read on, you will read that that is not the case. You referred to the Charter of Basic Rights, and you said that they are not right, because this is what they say. But what does it say? Let's take Article 34. It says in every paragraph, it says in accordance with the union law and the regulations and traditions in the national legislation. And this is relevant here. It talks to the right. It talks about the right to social support and assistance for all of those who don't have sufficient funds, that they should have the right to existence. Subsistence. And then it goes on to say, in accordance with the rules laid down by the union, that is the law that is now valid, not the laws that we want in the future, but this is in accordance with the valid laws, in accordance with union law and the national laws and practices. So then it goes on to say in the Charter of Basic Rights, in Article 51, it says it applies to the bodies, institutions, and other bodies of the European Union in accordance with the principle of subsidiarity, exclusively for the rights of the Union, and they have to abide by the principles and laws and promote their application in accordance with their responsibilities, also taking into account the limits to responsibilities that have been transferred to the Union, to the EU. This is something that you have to read. You have to read to the end. And when you say you've had legal experts look at it, Evan Light is a good friend of mine, and this is certainly not something that I agree with. I don't know how I should finish this sentence. If you have an independent legal review, then, of course, you have to have it checked by people who don't look at it to see what they can find in the text that they like. They have to look at the whole thing, look at it carefully, and see what decision the Commission will probably come to. That would be good legal advice. And in Brussels, you asked if I had that in writing, and I drew this up with my co-workers, and I did not emphasize it that much, but I said, take it seriously, have a look at it again, and I believe that it would only work via Article 156. And how should I put it? I was grateful for this information, but I can't find it in the text. In the reasoning for this, you included 156 as another support for this, but that was not what we were getting at. What we're calling upon the Commission to do, this has to be something that is legally admissible. That's what I'm trying to get at. The text of the ECI has to be legally admissible, and it should not include something that is not admissible from a legal point of view. Let me make this clear. At the Commission, well, how should I put it? It's not just a club of friends. We have to look at how the Commission thinks, how the majority thinks when it comes to democracy and also when it comes to economic questions. Take a look at what is going on in Europe now. It's just the other. It's just the total opposite. And if you have a few people in the Commission who are closer to us, you must admit that we are far from having the Commission as a whole on our side. So if the Commission has a reason to reject this, they will do so. They won't say, okay, we can find something which would allow us to agree to it. They're going to look for something which will allow them to reject it. So I'm making it much more clear than I have in the past. I've always said this. Now, I am going to a level which I try to avoid because I think it's not appropriate when it comes to the tone. But I'm making this very, very clear. I really depend on this. I don't want us to be up against a wall. So I think we need to take this into account. I'll send it out again, and I'd be happy. I haven't done this yet, but this was an older text. When this was a type of expert review, I can also come up with a proposal in the light of the text from the Commission on the 6th of September when they rejected it, and it won't be supported by the Parliament as a whole. No, we're far from that. And also the question of the convention, and with Hofstadt and with all of our colleagues in Parliament, we've been discussing this at length. But my problem here is that even colleagues who are close to us, who agree with us, they haven't been very talkative. They haven't said very much. We have a major crisis now in Europe. We don't just have the Commission and the Council and Member States and the ECB and the Eurogroup. We also have the Parliament, and the Parliament is not doing anything. I would like the Parliament to take on a major initiative and say that we have to arrive at a different policy in terms of economics and social aspects. We need more democracy in Europe. I've been trying and working on this ever since I joined the Parliament. In our Committee on Constitutional Questions, I am the coordinator of that group. We've managed to get the Parliament to make a proposal. It's rather complex. It's an initiative report, and in order to make an initiative report, it has to be approved by the President. And this was then finally approved after 9 months, and now we can do so. This was a great success. But what happened? The two big groups took this report, and not the ones who really wanted it. We cannot make the report, but the report is going to be drawn up by people who don't want this, and they will write the report in such a way that they will come up with just the opposite of what I had in mind. So it's not an easy situation we're in right now, not in the European Parliament either. We don't just have friends there. And I think this is something that we need to take into account when working on our strategy. That's why I think if we really want an ECI, then we need a wording that will make it impossible for them to reject. So everything has to be perfect. We can't just miss the point. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Any further questions from the floor? Yes, thank you. Thank you. Frieda Hart is the name. I'm very grateful for this discussion. Thank you very much. ECI is very important. And it's okay that it went wrong the first time around, because this shows us
where the problems are, and that there are many problems. It's about making a cultural change, not only about changing the law. It's very important that we are having this discussion, because a discussion about things is the most important thing. Of course, there is the legal point of view and then the legal review. We need to make progress when it comes to the treaties, and we need to have various strategies. ECI should be further promoted. It should find a new wording. However, now that we are faced with a rejection, we see that we are losing other options. Parliamentary question, for example. You are trying to pose a question, and this question is to be answered not only by the Commission, but also by the Parliament. That's an oral question. So, other members of the Parliament meet and then they talk about human rights, for example. Why are human rights so important? So the Commission has to discuss this question. Now, legal experts. There is a legal expert on human rights for every member state. So there are 27 experts. And the Parliament can ask the Commission to make the experts come up with an opinion, to really say what the relevance of an article is, whether human rights are important or not. That's another important thing that could be discussed in this context. So it's about fundamental research, really. In the long run, it's very important that we have these discussions to make the treaties progress, to further develop them. Now the Commission. The Commission is not just a monster. No, the Commission is composed of individuals. You cannot file an application to become a member of the Commission. No, these are well-educated people, functionaries. It's unbelievable work that is done there, and it's unbelievable what you have to do to try to talk to these people, to make them change. So it's unbelievable work, and we know how costly it is to try to convince someone. But this is work that has to be done, and that's all I wanted to say.
Ich guck auch ein bisschen auf die Uhr. Wir haben noch 5 Minuten.
We have 5 minutes left. Of course, we can go on for a bit longer, but we should try to finish on time. Further questions from the floor? Yes, there's one over there. And then Klaus Gerald. Wolfgang Siegert is the name. I have the following remark. The discussion showed what the spirit of the EU is. Now, from the outside, we have to start again. The EU stipulates that social affairs are very important, so we need to focus on this field. There are basics for a decision. We need to comment on them, and we need to present it to the European Commission. We need to say that we focus on social aspects, but we cannot implement social aspects if the framework is not given. But it's about referendums, and we can only have these referendums if we are backed up by a legal framework. Switzerland is an example, but it's not a member of the European Union. So if it can promote this topic nationally, then our opportunities also increase. So within the European Union, you could discuss bilateral treaties between the states, and it should be possible to make this topic basic income progress.
Mich würde Folgendes interessieren.
I'm interested in the following. It was asserted that it can only be accepted if it requires a legal act. This is wrong. Are there any binding legal acts and non-binding legal acts. So what is a non-binding legal act? Is that a recommendation or a statement? Maybe Gerald can give the concluding remarks. Unfortunately, the microphone is off. Yes, just 1 second. All right. Just very briefly, I would like to refer to a workshop by Guy Standing. He talked about strategies, and he talked about 17 points. Point one was that, of course, we all make mistakes. Yes, we made a mistake. It was rejected, so we did not really follow your advice. Now we can correct our ECI, and I would really like to ask Gerald to go through with your suggestion to come up with a wording for the ECI. We can then discuss this text within the group, and then we can start again. Maybe we can then convince the institutions of the second text. Now, very brief statement. It's actually a question, and maybe Gerald will be able to answer this question. You mentioned Article 51 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights, and you talked about subsidiarity. And I think subsidiarity is to solve problems at the lowest level. If you cannot solve them on that level, then you take it up one level. In the past 5 years, we discussed all the social aspects in the member states worsened. This is why I believe everyone failed. Subsidiarity means that we now have to discuss this on the European level. We need to improve the social aspects within the European Union. This is why the European Commission, as I believe, now is competent and responsible to take a decision. Well, I completely agree with what Klaus Sambor said. Gerald talked to legal experts in Brussels. He will talk to them again, and then he will submit a new text. The feasibility, we require the Commission to approve feasibility of unconditional basic income and then also have the Parliament decide on it. But Gerald knows what has to be done. And then the member states can go into the direction of unconditional basic income. This is what I ask you to do, but you knew this already, so I'm looking forward to your concluding remarks.
Peter.
Well, it's not just like trying to pass the buck. Well, let me say one thing. I'd be happy to prepare a proposal, but one thing I cannot do, as you said, is to present a text where I can be sure that it will go through. I can't guarantee that it will go through. And what you need to know, Zepp, is that it's sort of like it's almost like a mathematical formula. The more I put on this side, the less probable it will go through. So this is where we have to come up with the question of a political decision. There is no perfect text, a text where I can guarantee that it will be accepted, but then it will not have the content that you want. And if we put more into it, we also see that the probability will go down. I will try to come up with a text which I believe the probability of it being rejected will be much lower. And I would assume that the likelihood of it being accepted would be greater. I can agree to that. You're getting together tomorrow, I believe. I don't know if I can have it ready by tomorrow. I don't think so. Well, 2 o'clock. Well, it won't be the quality that you are requesting me to take with me to Brussels. Well, I can't just sign off on anything. I need to discuss this with legal experts. I can't manage that by tomorrow. By tomorrow, well, I would recommend that you don't try to decide on a text tomorrow. It doesn't work that way. Tomorrow you can discuss how we can move forward, and maybe 1, 2, or 3 drafts can be prepared, and then you can give it to lots of people to have them to look at it, not just legal experts who are on our side, but those who might be those with a lot of experience and are familiar with the arguments presented by the other side. I can give you a preliminary proposal tomorrow, and then when I have some more time, I can take a closer look at it. Now let's turn to the questions. The first question came from Frieda Hart. There is the legal and also the sense of justice. And I'm grateful for that comment, because we shouldn't make a mistake and simply look at what the laws are today. No, it's just the other way around. This goes beyond the current legal situation, not only here, but I think people have come much further. They're much more advanced than the laws are. So this sense of justice is much further advanced than the laws themselves are. They think much more in terms of social cohesion. They want more justice. And today's laws move in the opposite direction. But if we can get the sense of justice and the legal situation to be the same, then this will have to be achieved through democracy. And oral question, of course, we can do things in that area as well, and this would accompany it all. But what's most important here is not just to hope that somebody in Parliament or in the Commission will make such a statement. That would be encouraging, but what we need to do first and foremost is to develop awareness in the community, in the population, so that this will really be dealt with in Europe. Otherwise, nothing will happen. And I'd also like to say the following. It might not sound like very much to you, but it's important to me. We're not talking about a battle or a struggle as to how to word an ECI, and then this will be part of our law tomorrow. This is a struggle that might take decades, might take even years. We're talking about a struggle which will take a lot of time, and I'm sure that only with this attitude, only in this way, will we be successful. But we will be successful if we take on this attitude. What else did I want to say? It doesn't necessarily have to be a legal act, subsidiarity. Well, you have to realize that what you said is a different interpretation of subsidiarity as it is now worded. The way it is worded now goes back to the fact that in the convention there was a separate working group which discussed when the laws of the union should stop and where should the laws for the member states begin. Where is the line to be drawn? It was hard to draw a precise line, but to protect regional and national authorities, they put into the law what I read out to you earlier on. It is valid law. It can be amended. We could say we need more Europe, but then, of course, we would have to change the law. In the contracts or treaties, the area that we're talking about now, it is still national competence, national jurisdiction. What we're trying to achieve on a European level is one thing, but we also have to have campaigns in all of the member states. That's important. And at the European level, I believe that we will achieve this if we manage to have a movement which will result in an overall revision of the treaties. I think that is necessary. That is probably the most probable way for us to succeed, because if we come up with a convention that is different from what we have so far and totally different from what we have now and what is planned by the authorities in Brussels, this would be a convention that might say we will consult on something for 3 years as to how we in Europe want to achieve social justice, solidarity, and democracy, how all these three aspects can be reinforced. We're going to start from the beginning. How should it look? What should it be like in Europe? What rights do we need? What laws do we need? And then we can publish the proposal, the proposed convention. Then it will take 6 months. It will be discussed in the different member states. And then initiatives from civil society can be taken. They can make their own proposals. And then the convention will come together again for another 6 to 12 months. And we'll discuss all of this in the light of the public discussions. And then at the end of the day, there will be a referendum in Europe to determine what approach Europe wants to take. And I think this is how we can get things through, because then the citizens will have the final say. At the last convention, everyone knew that everything that we propose is something that is has to be accepted by the heads of state and government, because they had the final say. So if I propose a treaty that is to meet with the approval of the heads of state and government, it will be a different text as opposed to a text which would be accepted by the population at large. So if I choose such a democratic approach, and if this is acceptable, then this can be something that will enshrine the basic income in the text. Thank you very much. So all I can do is say thank you very much to everyone. Thank you for such a constructive and productive discussion amongst friends. And I think we have learned a lot. And my request to you is to take this idea of unconditional basic income, pass this idea along to the outside world, and maybe to support it. Thank you very much to Klaus Sambor, Gerald Hefner, and Sepp Kustatschew for such a pleasant discussion. Thank you very much.